Welcome to the 3030 Health Podcast. The following discussion is for education and entertainment. It is not intended to diagnose or treat disease. Please do not apply any of this information without first discussing it with your doctor. Here is your host, Dr. Ruiz.
Hello, everyone. Super excited about today's show with my friends, integrative nurse practitioner Melanie Dorian and Dr. Robert Abbott. In today's show, we discuss their functional medicine training platform, Pentad Integrative Health. They have recently released their first module on digestive health, and we give a nice overview about the way they plan to train future practitioners. They are kindly offering a scholarship open to naturopathic students to get their first module for free. So if you're a naturopathic student, stick around until the end of the episode to take advantage of this awesome opportunity. Finally, I have some great news. I was selected to present at PaleoFX for the second year in a row. If you haven't got your tickets, look for the link on the show notes. I can't wait to see you in Austin. I hope you enjoyed the show. Hello, everyone. Super excited for today's show. I have two of my best friends in this space, Rob Abbott and Melody Dorian. How are you guys?
I'm doing great.
I'm doing pretty good as well, Guillermo. Thanks.
You know, you guys were on last year, early in the year, and we discussed the future of functional medicine. And you guys have not been just, you know, twiddling your thumbs. You guys have been actually working really hard, and you guys have some awesome news and a cool thing that's being launched pretty soon. But before we get into that, Rob and Melanie, what have you guys been doing since last we spoke?
We've been incredibly busy. There's been a lot of late nights, early mornings. So I founded Pentad Integrative Health not quite a year ago. And it's really designed for online modules with flexibility, both, you know, visual, audio, with handouts to teach the foundations of integrative and functional medicine. And this was a response to really needing more flexibility and more affordability and to learning this medicine. So very shortly into starting designing this curriculum, and I had spent a lot of time with Rob. He spent time at my clinic, so I knew him really well, and I trust his knowledge base, and I love working with Rob. So recruited Rob to come and help me out. And so we've been designing content to teach the foundations of this medicine that we're also passionate about. And we've created now two modules. We're launching tonight, actually, the GI imbalances module. And we did beta testing with weight management module. And that one's getting tweaked a little bit and should be within a month probably relaunched. So that's what we've been up to while Rob is in residency, while I'm working full time. So we're creating this online curriculum for people to learn the foundation. That's really what we're doing.
What about you, Rob? Have you been twiddling your thumbs?
I have definitely been doing the opposite.
Excuse me. It's Dr. Abbott, MD.
Correct.
You're too kind, Guillermo. So yeah, I have been in my residency since last June, so June of 2016. It's funny, I think last time we talked, I was waiting to find out where I was going to be for my residency. And I am still in the state of Virginia in a small community residency program that's been really just wonderful. I've had a great experience so far. You know, long weeks, long hours, but I've been very lucky to kind of spend a little free time I have with Melanie and some of my close friends to kind of keep growing in the space. I mean, I know, you know, Guillermo, we finally got to meet in the interim time last September at the Ancestral Health Symposium, which was a great event and great networking and just kind of further inspired me to further this movement. And then was just really lucky that Melanie came to me and asked for some guidance, some help, and to partner in this. And it's been something that I've been really glad to take a part in, because I'm really getting to be a better clinician. I mean, all the research that we're doing it's crazy to think how much time we've spent, and I already am becoming a better clinician simply from pouring into the literature. So I have certainly been busy, but enjoying myself nonetheless.
Last time we spoke, we talked about functional medicine and how I don't believe like there's alternative medicine. There's either medicine or not medicine, and how functional medicine is this branch of the model that, you know, is evidence-based but focuses on removing the obstacles to health. What do you guys put into these modules or into Pentad, and how do you define this movement of functional medicine or complementary medicine?
So we're really trying to narrow it down. And like Rob called it months ago when we were trying to figure out our curriculum at one point, he said, we have to be ruthless, Melanie. We really have to narrow down to what really is the core basics. That's the most evidence-based for what we're trying to teach peers who want to learn this. So really, it's about getting to the really good foundational things to do with every new patient who's coming into us with really chronic complex illnesses or not, even if it's a simpler complaint. But it's really about narrowing it down to really the core foundations, things that allow people to think a little bit and a lot outside of the box, but really making sure they're comfortable with, let's start thinking a little bit outside of the box. Let's really equip people and peers with some really solid tools and some really solid knowledge. I mean, our reference section, which Rob is the mastermind behind that, is a beast. And I mean, we've been reading and reviewing science to make sure that what we're doing is actually aligns with the most updated research. And all of us go to so many conferences and we collaborate with peers and say, like, oh yeah, I noticed from somewhere. Okay, yeah, let's bring it back and let's make sure it actually truly aligns with what the evidence says as much as possible and then support that. So really what we're doing, like you said, is removing the obstacles to healing, but really teaching the foundations of what that means. And making sure that there's some core tools that people have, both with testing, with management, with follow-up. How do we address the core tools and the core basic principles so that people, clinicians, can go out there and feel empowered and equipped, and they can do these things. And a lot of what we're teaching are foundational, and they can apply. While PENTAD is dividing things into topic, into modules, but a lot of these core, this core information is applicable to almost any condition. You know, go back to the basics. What's going on with detox? What's going on with the immune system? What's going on with inflammation? What's going on with the metabolism? You know, how's their mood doing? Like neuropsych, that's hugely overlooked, I feel, in traditional medicine. And that's where we shine in functional and integrative medicine, is we really narrow it down. And that's why the facets are critical. So the facets of every module teaches a core foundation for someone who didn't study naturopathic medicine, who maybe doesn't understand this big holistic picture. Don't miss, go through every one of these facets, the six facets, the core one really being diet and lifestyle, and then address every other one by one, or you can start and there's no particular order, but address all these things to make sure that the patient gets the best care, and our recommendations are always as much as possible evidence-based and the most recent science when we have it. We don't always have randomized controlled trials, but when we do have good evidence, we got to make sure that we align with that. So that's really what we're trying to do. It's removing obstacles to healing, but doing it with aligning ourselves with science and aligning ourselves with also what's working with clinicians and really collaborating. Like we've collaborated with a lot of people. Rob and I talked to a lot of people. What are you guys doing? What's working? What's not working? And making sure we give the foundational. That's really our goal.
So Rob, you know, now you're doing your residency and you are in the, you know, allopathic medical model. How has this PENTAD training or, you know, putting it together, how has it helped you guide your residency? Or, you know, because we talk off and on, you know, we'll text each other about cool cases that we've seen and we'll always discuss. And I'm always surprised about how much of this holistic or integrative approach you're taking with some of your patients. So how is this helping you become a better doctor?
Yeah, it's quite profound, actually. When I was working with Melanie in her clinic as a fourth-year student, you know, that was pretty, you know, fairly traditional family medicine, but also, you know, people seeking functional medicine in an outpatient clinic. Now, as part of my residency training so far, a lot of our first year is spent in the hospital. So it's really a different, very different setting. I mean, you're seeing a very different type of patient in terms of the degree of their illness. Now, that being said, there's a lot of acute exacerbations of chronic illnesses or relative organ failure related to, you know, certain chronic disease states. And you would think that it would be impossible to employ any type of functional medicine in that setting. And what I've actually found, and what's been really helpful to work in working with Melanie, is making things even more basic. So I think we could probably all agree here that in the functional medicine space, in the ancestral health space, we've all been to conferences and we start talking about things like, you know, how many oxalates are in my meal. And that can be a little esoteric when we haven't even addressed a core diet, you know, lifestyle habits. And while it's interesting, while I like to be around those discussions and it's a stimulate positive conversation, that's not the thing I need to be focusing on with the 75-year-old type 2 diabetic who's been a diabetic, you know, 35, 40 years. And me to actually go back to that simple core. And if anything, I'll just pick one of the facets for an individual and try to find where's the in, where's the gateway for this person. And I've had a lot of success, you know, in helping people both with some of the chronic, you know, metabolic illnesses, diabetes, heart disease, heart failure, and implementing some core lifestyle changes and even targeted supplementation to help support their well-being, starting that the conversation in the hospital setting. I've also had quite a bit of success with autoimmune disease. Mm-hmm. So patients coming in and their acute reason for being in the hospital may not always be related to their autoimmune condition, but it's staggering how many people come in and when you're reviewing their medical history, have some autoimmune disease. And when, you know, you probe into it, they've been on an immune suppressant drug for quite some time and they don't really think much of it because maybe it's been fairly well controlled. Yet I see that as a tremendous red flag. And oh, you should use that as a gateway to start talking about, you know, immune and inflammation, obviously, but of gut disruption and helping people focus on their gut health and what things that they might be able to do foundationally to do that. But yeah, realistically, it's helped me to kind of come back and build a really solid foundation before we go out and just, you know, really get into some more esoteric and potentially more complicated tests that are out there in functional medicine. Let's use this core. And that's exactly what PENTAT is supposed to be. You know, I made the analogy, I think, to Melanie early on, like we're not trying to get people from A to Z when it comes to functional medicine. We want to get them from A to L. We want a core foundation because lots of people think they're at T or U in the alphabet when realistically they're more at like a B or C. And so we need to help people realize that and, you know, do that core. And I had to admit a lot of things that I didn't quite know and come back to it. So hopefully people can hear that and say like, yes, I'm excited and want something that's really foundational and will give me a core understanding from a practical clinical perspective, what I can do to help people, you know, as a practitioner, help myself as a patient or layperson.
Now, Melanie, you know, you mentioned going to a lot of conferences. That's been my, you know, before we start this call, you know, before we start recording, we were talking about like going to specialty trainings and trying to learn new specialty tests. And, you know, this test sometimes can be a little bit expensive. Like, for example, in my practice, you know, we are a cash-based practice. So the patient has to pay for them out of their own pocket, which, you know, creates the true system of healthcare that we need because now the patient is involved in their care and it's not just paying a copay. But that's a different podcast. In your practice, are your patients self-selected and are looking for a functional medicine practitioner? Or do you have people that have no idea and they just waltz into your consult room?
I'm in an insurance-based practice, so family practice, maybe 12 clinicians in my practice. We're independent from hospital settings, and we're insurance-based, Medicare, Medicaid included. So I have to be incredibly selective with what I recommend for most of my patients. I see, and I'm a adult geriatric medicine specialist, so I see a lot of Medicare patients. So a lot of the functional integrative tools that I've brought in, I took into account cost and who may get some insurance coverage. While let's consider all the best testing out there, but then who might get some insurance coverage, insurance reimbursement? So I get a really interesting mix, which always keeps my days fascinating. I'll have some patients, they were referred to me and I was referred to as a nutritionist and they have no idea what I do. They didn't read anything about functional integrative medicine. They didn't read any of my bio or my posts on our website. So they have no idea. So I have a little, you know, 2-minute spiel. Rob's heard it many a times of what I do and how I'm going to engage them into their care. And they can make a decision whether or not this is the type of care they would like. And I tell people, I'm going to be your best coach and your best cheerleader, but you're going to have to participate. You're going to have to do your sport every day on the ground. You're living it. I'm going to guide you through it, and I'm going to remove obstacles. But if I give you the best training plan, but you're not going to execute, I don't care who you are on the other end. You can be a total beginner in your sport. This can be a completely new sport, but I'm going to set the pace based on the feedback you're giving me. So I tell them it's going to be regular follow-ups, and you're going to be very engaged in your care. So I have those patients where I have to completely explain what I do. They have no idea. They've never heard the term functional medicine. So that's maybe a fourth or fifth of my practice. And then I have the other ones who, small town where we are, huge amount of word of mouth, and also a lot of internal referrals because we're a 12 clinician practice. So I get a lot of internal referrals, and people have often a better idea of what I do. And then I have a significant population, the word of mouth outside of the practice. They seek me because of my functional training. So I get a little bit of everything in one day. I mean, I'll see 12 to 15 patients in a day because it's an insurance-based practice. I see a lot of diversity. I see a lot of patients every day. And I get a really interesting mix. So I'll have to like tell my spiel from the very beginning to someone who's like, they don't want the spiel. They don't care. They know the functional testing. They already have the list of things they want to do. Like, let's just agree, boom, let's go, hit the ground running. So I get a little bit of everything, which is awesome. I love it. I love the diversity.
I bet that's very exciting for a patient who has no idea of what we do to walk in and sit down and then like, oh, she's actually talking to me.
Oh, yeah, they love it. And I have so many people, they start crying because I'm the first one who's listened to them in years. And I'm first one who believes them. That's the big thing. You've got to believe the suffering you're seeing on the other end. And we really try, and Rob and I put that out there in Pentad. Suffering is real, guys. This is for real. And people have PTSD from the medical system. And it's our job to undo that. And we have to take that responsibility seriously. And I tell that to my patients. I believe everything you're saying here, I believe. And it's probably rooted in some of the core things that we're going to work on. But I need to engage. And so if you listen to them and you work with them, and to tell some of these people, you know, this is rural. We're in the middle of rural Virginia. And to tell someone who's a good old boy who just got off his tractor, and I see those every week, and I'm telling them, listen, you can get off of these meds and you can actually feel good. You know, right now you're having a hard time pushing on the pedals because your neuropathy is so bad. I might be able to stop that and reverse it. You have to listen to me. You have to work with me. People start crying every week because no one has ever told them that there's a possibility to actually heal. And I tell them, I go into every room and every patient, doesn't matter who you are, how sick you are, I believe in the power of healing. That's not my job. I just remove obstacles. Then it's the body's job to do its thing, and it will. It will do its thing, and you will get better if we address the four issues. And that's what I tell patients, and it's so empowering. I have people who've never, ever heard this, ever. And they're empowered. Last week, Friday, I had this woman. She said, man, I think I was a little bit thick here at the beginning because it's taken me 4 months to understand. Telling me at every follow-up, she says, I get it now. I'm better. I'm feeling better. It's another digestive case with, you know, chronic allergies and hives and all that. And it was all gut-rooted and lifestyle. You did such simple things. Basics like Pentad and basic facets, went through them, removed obstacles. She followed up. She's engaged. She's excited. She says, my eczema is getting better. My eczema hasn't gotten better in 10 years, you know, and now she understands. Now she has a toolbox to help herself. No one had ever taught her how to take care of herself. No one gave her the hope that there is something above and beyond steroid creams. No one. So it's so rewarding to do this when you have someone who's never heard of this. Like, this is the most stimulating, empowering thing of what I do.
You know, it's amazing the stuff that we do. Things like Dr. Nasha Winters, you know, and the work that she's doing with spontaneous remission of cancer, and, you know, all these different practitioners that are doing all this awesome stuff. I came to the movement because I wanted to be like them. I wanted to be like Cresser. I wanted to be like Ruscio. I wanted to be like Rob Abbott. You know, I wanted to be like all this. I wanted to be like all these badasses. But we're like, okay, I graduated. I've done all of this stuff. Now what? You know, I have a license. I can prescribe. And unfortunately, there's a lot of self-learning that we have to do within the medical profession. And what I love about Pentad is that this is like a, I don't want to call it a shortcut because it's very comprehensive, but this is a good way of starting your functional medicine practice. And it's very digestible. You know, it's very easy to follow. You know, spoiler alert, I've been privy to this training. They sent me a link and I was like, whoa, this is actually really cool, because you have taken 5 to 7 different conferences and basically extracted all of the most important material and all of the most important stuff. And you don't have to, you know, you don't necessarily have to apply all of it, but you are exposed to all of the things that are working in functional medicine and how to bring them into your practice, or even as a student, how to talk about this functional test with your attending physician and how to deliver them to your patients. So how did you guys select, and let's talk specifically about the GI module, how do you guys select which facets were going to be placed, and how do you guys come up with like the schedule, or how the different
piece it together?
You just took a hat, and then, because it's very comprehensive and the timing of the way that things are laid out, it's very important.
Yes. So the 5 facets are always the same. We go into the intro, we introduce the condition or what we're addressing. So GI imbalances, we introduce the things we're going to focus on. And it's really based on Rob and I's clinical experience. What are we seeing the most in primary care and family practice? What brings people in? So we narrow down to conditions, and then the introduction is really what initial tests are you going to be using, an overview of these conditions. And then we go over metabolism. How are GI imbalances going to impact someone's metabolism? And there's a lot of endocrine, so the HPA axis and thyroid. And then, of course, we go, there's a digestive and detox facet. That one's a beast, obviously, for the GI module. It's in three 20-minute segments in the video and the audio. And then there's immune and inflammation. And then there's neuropsych, which Rob really focused on neuropsych. He nailed it. It's amazing, actually. It's one of my favorite facets. So we had a pretty solid outline, and then we created the content, and then we got ruthless with the content. Cut this out. Is it necessary as an introduction, as a basic? We're teaching. Let's really review. We're teaching the foundations. And even during the recording of this module, at one point, I went over it. I go over the outline with our videographer. He's like, going to be too long. Like, ruthless, like, narrow it down. What's the most important steps? I recorded a part of a facet, and I'm like,
yeah.
I'm like, oh, hey, Rob, I'm sitting there redoing in the middle of the video session. Like, I'm going to redo this PowerPoint right now. So, video guy, Seth Coogan, go take a coffee break, and I'm going to redo my PowerPoint. It's really about narrowing down to the good, solid basics. And then what are people going to need tomorrow morning? I don't want this to take 2 months to integrate. What are they going to do tomorrow morning? So we were super ruthless in what are we seeing? And there was a lot of back and forth between Rob and I in the outline. I mean, what are we seeing? And also, like, what are we really, we got to present things that is solid evidence-based. So we got to review that and really make sure we understand the studies that we're introducing and that we're presenting. So that's really how we came about the GI imbalances. There was a ton of work, a lot. There's literally like some 1 and 2 a.m. texting and messaging back and forth about, we've got to finish this. Here's how I rework this facet. Here's how I rework this content. We're still kind, but we're pretty critical, and it's really good constructive feedback. Like, this, no, this doesn't work, or I don't think we should put this in, and let's rework the flow like this, and bring in each other's, like, supporting each other's strengths and weaknesses. So it's a ton of work. It's amazing. We're pretty much, it's an online textbook. So, I mean, it's days and days and days of work for every facet, and there's 5 facets per module.
You know, Melanie has done a great job of really explaining how it's organized. And, you know, this education is broken down. The first time we actually recorded and did some beta testing, you know, we had longer videos and people were like, it's awesome content, but yeah, the videos are too long. So we've made the videos between 15 to maybe 22, 23 minutes in length. Things are broken down. and it's organized around some core key objectives, some core key learning objectives and summary points. And we have some amazing handouts that go even more in depth than the videos that you can use as the person's going along with each of the facets to take notes and to integrate what they're learning. You know, I'll be honest and say I've done a ton of training outside of my formal medical training, you know, to be an MD. I've done, you know, lots of functional and ancestral training, have been to these conferences, but you know, I did the Foundational Institute for Functional Medicine training. I took part in Chris Kresser's 1-year-long adapt clinician training. I've done two other sort of smaller trainings, but I've spent a lot of time in training, and I'll say, you know, specifically, you know, Chris Kresser really turned me on to the understanding of changing how we learn. And I think, you know, we talked about this a year ago with the ebook and trying to introduce content and get people empowered to say, hey, go check out these resources, find out how you, you know, learn best and grow from there. You know, don't get lost in the Google world. And so, you know, I really try to take some of that to heart. And if of all the things that, you know, academia and medical school does well, is there's some great structure, there's some great organization, some very core foundational learning. Like, how do you learn? How do you, you know, study? That I've been able to apply to and bring to the table with PENTAT. And, you know, I would say if this was available when I was a student, I mean, it would be a game changer. I mean, I had to go, and what's in that ebook from last year, you know, was basically my search. Like, you know, what the heck is out there? What's free? Because I can't go to, you know, these conferences. I can't pay for these trainings. I'm a student. And even then, I don't really know what I'm getting. And so this, you know, PENTAT is meant to be really, really accessible, but be sort of a comprehensive training for people who really want to get interested. And I've had plenty of people reach out to me after the ebook and have tons of questions about, you know, what path should I take in functional medicine, this and that. And now I can, you know, really have something and say, hey, start with these videos, start with this core content, you know, follow these core people. If you like podcasts, I can give people a pretty good push out the door of some really good content that's going to help them, you know, because it's just, it's overwhelming when you, if you think you have to go to the Institute for Functional Medicine's core trainings and drop thousands of dollars, or do, you know, a year-long course and drop thousands of dollars to get a good education. You don't have to do that. And you can do it on your own time. And that's really what PENTAT's about.
And, you know, in another thing that I found fascinating is that you guys have curated some specialty testing that you use for the GI section. You know, you have very specific, this is what we do and this is why. This is what is working in my practice. And I imagine that if that changes or you find a better test, or, you know, that would be updated. But most importantly is that, for example, I work at an endocrinology office, and, you know, 90% of the patients that I see have endocrinology problems. I can't wait for the mental health module, because if someone comes in with some mental health issues, I'm not an expert. Thankfully, you know, I have a practice that I can refer out. It's not going to be the difference between me turning off the lights and closing the office. Because if you have too many that you're referring out, then what happens? But you also don't want to be a bad practitioner and just do something that, you know, that you're not comfortable with. This bridges that gap. If you don't have the answer to what's presented in front of you, and that's with any type of medicine, you go back to the basics, ABC, airway, breathing, circulation. And then the naturopathic basics would be sleep, food, movement, you know, spirituality, you know, because we might not have the answer to cancer, but we have the answer to health, and making that person a little bit healthier, whether it's physically, spiritually, or however you want to slice it, it's going to be better for that patient. With this module, if you fell asleep during your GI classes at school, or maybe you have like a pain management center, or, you know, you're geeking out over like Pearl therapy, and that's all you see all the time. And then you got someone and you're like, you know what? I heard that Rob Wolf podcast and I think this guy has SIBO. Where do I start? And by having this module and going through the whole module, you have an understanding of how to treat a person the next day after you've listened. And that to me is priceless, because just going to each one of these specialty testing conferences is going to run you around $1,000.
Oh, at the very least.
You know, before we start talking about specialty testing, okay, what are the five facets of PenTat? You know, what are the five things that you hit on every single one of these modules that are going to be released?
Our core focus is diet and lifestyle, and that's really the core of integrative and functional medicine. That's actually a free facet that's up on the website right now, which is pentatintegrativehealth.com. Anybody can have access to that. It costs zero, so you can look at that. And then the five facets that surround the core focus, we have the intro, which really introduces the condition, core testing, then there's metabolism, and then there's going to be digestion and detox, inflammation and immune, and then their neuropsych. So every single condition, we go over these five facets, and we really take out the most important and pertinent items based on the condition. So GI imbalances, we focus in all of these facets on everything that pertains very specifically to GI imbalances. How is GI imbalances affecting your thyroid? How is GI imbalances affecting your immune and your inflammatory pathways? So we really nailed it down. So every condition, that's what we're doing.
And it's so important, you know, I don't know, you know, any gunners out there with medical school, if you ever watched the Pathoma videos, those videos are amazing because they explain the physiology. And sometimes, you know, we forget about the physiology whenever we start teaching something, and you guys take time to explain some physiology of what's going on. And that was pretty cool. That was very refreshing, actually.
Yeah. And we, again, ruthless, it's not a 2-hour rabbit hole like Rob likes to call it, you know, pathophysiology of research. We're going to like go give you the quick overview that you need to understand why this protocol, why this treatment, or why this study, and with a very basic physiology or pathophysiology associated with it. So we really, really narrowed it down, nailed it down to the most important parts, or we think so.
So let's talk about like the meat and potatoes of the actual training. Okay. On the GI module, what testing do you guys cover?
So depending on which section we're talking about, but the digestion and detox specific facet, I mean, we talk about advanced stool testing. We also talk about the standard testing. Let's not forget the standard stool testing that you can do through, you know, Quest, LabCorp, the standard labs, and some of the basic blood markers for some imbalances, GI imbalances and GI conditions, allergy testing. And then we also go into advanced and functional testing, like advanced stool testing and food sensitivity testing, for example, breath testing for SIBO. So we go into the advanced testing, but we also review some of the basic tests that even if you don't have any functional and integrative testing in your clinic, what are the core basics again to do? But then in the metabolism facet or the immune facet, we talk about some other integrative and functional testing that you can do. And like the immune facet, what are the oxidative stress markers that we can use? And what are some other inflammatory markers? And like using homocysteine, which you can do, for example, anybody can order homocysteine. It doesn't have to be through an integrative specialized lab. It gets fairly well covered by insurance because I have to be mindful of that in my practice. So what are the other things that you can do outside of a SED rate and, you know, CBC chem panel and CRP? Like, what are the other markers that are valuable, seem to be well validated? And then we go also into more advanced testing, some of the like oxidative stress markers that you can use. There's definitely a lot of stuff, but we've had to narrow it down to address the core conditions. We talk about, you know, home self-testing for stomach acid, for example, which is a really valuable tool when you're considering GI imbalances. So that's part of the handout has the step-by-step protocol and how to instruct patients on how to do stomach acid level testing at home and do it themselves. So that's probably the couple bullet points, cliff notes of some of the testing that we talk about in the GI imbalances module.
And what conditions are covered?
So we talk about generally dysbiosis, imbalances between good and bad bugs, how to address that. And then we talk about constipation, because that's something we see a lot actually in primary care. And we talk about SIBO, We do talk a little bit about celiac and IBS and IBD. We don't go into a ton of depth into that because it's more standard medicine realm when you get into IBD, but we do talk about that a little bit and some of the markers associated with that, with both standard and non-standard and functional testing. So those are the main conditions that we talk about. There's a section, a little short section on also for people who have indigestion and reflux, what do you do and how do you support these patients? Because that's also, it's bread and butter for someone doing integrative and functional medicine. People are, you know, constipated, they're bloated, and they have reflux. So those are really the big, big ones that I see in my practice and in generally in primary care. I did validate that with other colleagues at my clinic and outside of my clinic in terms of what are they seeing? So what conditions do we need to address?
Yeah, I mean, those are some of the core GI imbalances. I think what's interesting with the facets is we allow people to look at these conditions both holistically, but within the context of these sort of more organized facets. So Melanie had mentioned earlier that one of my focuses was the neuropsychological facet within GI imbalances. And so I bring up a point in that video where, you know, some of the therapies that are available for people, you know, a lot's been studied with irritable bowel syndrome, this sort of categorization of symptoms. And, you know, a lot of people have been told that it's all in their head, which as we know here, that's really not true. Components of the person's perception and a psychological component would also be incorrect. And so we introduce, you know, some associations between disease states, actually to some things like, you know, autism and ADHD, schizophrenia, certain, you know, classic diagnoses that are out there, but, you know, mental health pathology that actually could be coming from core GI issues. And there'll be, you know, later modules looking at mental health that'll be focused that, you know, the digestion and detox facet of that module, we'll get more in depth to that. So I focus more on the sort of neuropsychological treatments, the psychological treatments for people with primary GI issues. But you can start to, you know, look around and see people that come to your clinic who are anxious and depressed and start to like ding, 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 ding. Actually, you know, maybe that's more of a symptom of a core GI imbalance. So I bring up the point of, you know, what really is that primary root? We need to be curious. But at the same time, we introduce some therapies that are primarily just neuropsychologically based, and people get better, right? So people with IBS or IBD, some of these conditions will get better simply from a psychological-based therapy without doing anything diet or lifestyle-oriented or any of the other, you know, therapies, you know, introduced in the digestion and detox facet. And so I think, you know, it's just helpful to see that you can keep the whole picture. We narrow things down within each facet, and we'll bring up certain disease states, you know, and describe these associations. Then you can bring it back out to that sort of 20,000 foot, you know, view and see how you can apply this to really anything that you're doing. So we've been talking a lot about family care, but you could be a specialist. You could be a student who is more interested in cardiology, and this can be applicable for you. You're going to get a greater toolkit, a greater capacity to care for your patients. Like I think you were saying, you know, earlier, Guillermo, we can, you know, acknowledge the type of patient that's coming into our clinic. If it's a more specialty patient, you know, for you, it sounds like the endocrinology and thyroid is a big focus. And when someone comes in with, you know, anxiety, depression, and panic disorder, it may be like, whoa, I need to send you out the door. Actually, what we present at PINTAD is that maybe that's not necessarily the case. If you have a strong core foundation, you might be able to offer that person something and realize that at the core, it's a GI issue that's your bread and butter. So hopefully that was a helpful way to sort of describe the interrelationships between the facets and what's in the core of PINTAD.
And then most importantly is that you guys are providing with skeletons of treatment options that you guys use for these patients, like for someone with SIBO, for someone with dysbiosis, you know, help with, you know, interpreting a lab and that's telling you, okay, this person has hydrogen dominant SIBO, this is what we do. Can you talk a little bit about that and how do you guys curate those treatment protocols?
So, you know, we really looked at the things that were clinically, some of the evidence behind some of the protocols that we were using. For SIBO, for example, I mean, it's hard to talk about SIBO without talking about antibiotics such as Xifaxan or Rifaximin and possibly adding other agents, flagyl, neomycin. So we go over that a little bit, but that's not where our focus was. We mentioned those therapies. those guidelines are fairly easy to find, but we looked into some of the herbals and some of the other treatments that have been successful. We put a lot of our core main protocols in there, so that gives people a place to start. But we look also at the whole picture with SIBO. SIBO is complicated. There's motility, there's the migrating motor complex issues, there's stomach acid issue, there's the neuropsych part where people are eating in fight or flight mode. There's so much involved in SIBO. So we try to go into the comprehensive approach and look at the very least at some of the herbal protocols, give some people some options, a place to start, and then you can tweak the protocol based on that. So, you know, I've reworked my SIBO protocol now for over 4 years. I've been doing this, and based on the work of Dr. Seebecker, which she's a great resource for SIBO, and reworked my herbal protocol now, and I think it's at a good place where I'm getting quite a bit of success. It's well tolerated, and people are getting better. So, and emphasizing that for some patients, SIBO is going to be chronic and there's going to be a lot of relapses, but there's going to be fewer of them if you address the migrating motor complex, if you address the stomach acid. For me in my practice, that's been probably the biggest key, is addressing hypochlorhydria, so low stomach acid, and really addressing that and having patients understand what we're doing and really why they need to be often on more than just one round or just 1 month of herbals and everything else that comes with it. The SIBO, you picked a hard one. The SIBO is a really comprehensive approach. But what we did is we introduce the core things. What can you do? Again, tomorrow morning, your patient's bloated. Let's walk you through what the breath test is. Have your patient tested. As soon as the breath test is mailed, here are the couple things you can already start them that might make them better. A couple things. It doesn't have to be complicated. Something like bone broth, or if they don't have histamine issues, or a good collagen gelatin product, and probably some of these probiotics, gentle probiotics at the beginning because we don't know what's going on, and maybe glutamine. You know, like, where do they start? How can we provide some relief? So narrow it down, again, to some of the basic core things. And that's what we did with SIBO. And then we go into the advanced protocol of all the herbals. Great, the test comes back, it's positive. What do you do with methane, non-methane dominant? What are the herbals and the supplements that you can do? Also, I mean, we do mention some antibiotics, but really what we want to do is go into all the integrative things that you can do to help. And Rob brings in a really great depth of knowledge in the neuropsych facet as how can we get that migrating motor complex reactivated? And what can you do actually to help with the dysmotility when you have a SIBO with a constipation type? How can you help these patients? And every facet has really, really good applicable tool in Pentab that you can do this tomorrow morning with your patient.
And, you know, and I picked SIBO for a reason, because, like, I see a lot of endo. We know that if we have a hypothyroid, that affects your migrating motor complex. And then you try to do something, you know, you try to eat fiber because the doctor told you the fiber is good, and it ferments in your small intestine. So then you start getting some overgrowth in your small intestine. That creates some intestinal permeability, which exacerbates your hypothyroid. So it's like this vicious cycle. So addressing the dysmotility has been like gold when it comes to treating a person that has hypothyroid with bloating and having, you know, like the distension after eating, you know, hard as a rock, or they'll say, oh, it's like I'm pregnant, you know, and it's like, bingo.
Yeah, I know.
So being able to have like this, like gold nuggets, you know, that you can latch onto and identify. Because I've had patients, you know, that maybe this is not their first functional medicine doctor they've seen, and they were diagnosed with SIBO, and they were given oil of oregano. And they were like, yeah, you know, it kind of works, but having the, you know, the explanation and having the a little bit of the pathophysiology and the reasoning why prokinetics are important, a reason why digestive enzymes are important, you know, being able to tell your patient, this is going to be a difficult protocol. It's not forever. We're going to do it for a month, 6 weeks. You know, it might be shorter if we do the antibiotic route, but, you know, we're going to address possible biofilms with some N-acetylcysteine. We're going to use some Model Pro or some erythromycin to help you move, and maybe some magnesium citrate. We're going to use some botanicals at these doses, you know, three times a day, because botanicals are, you know, you have to dose them high and often. And then, you know, by putting together this protocol, now you're giving the patient the power, you know, because before, just like Pentad, attacking the problem from so many different angles, just one angle was being treated, which was the dysbiosis. You also have to heal the gut, you know, and that migrating motor complex is not going to heal as soon as the bacteria is dead. It takes months actually to regrow those neural connections. So being able to, for example, the problem, okay, is SIBO. The symptom is distension. The chronic symptom might be that's what caused your hypothyroidism. So we can give you thyroid medication and that's going to help you with your hypothyroid, but didn't address anything else. I can give you an antibiotic to minimize dysbiosis. It didn't address anything else.
Yeah. And that's, I mean, when they end up in a specialist's office, and that's what happened is the, okay, great. If for some reason the specialist did, thank you, test for SIBO, then they were given an antibiotic and then sent home and not discussed any of the what, you know, we look at in the core facets. And in the metabolism facet, there's a pretty extensive section on thyroid. Every module has a thyroid section, but the section in the GI module on the links between GI imbalances, especially with SIBO and constipation with thyroid, I mean, it's pretty extensive and the literature is out there. And that's not like voodoo that we're doing in integrative or naturopathic medicine or functional medicine. Like, this is for real. Like, people are suffering, and if they're not optimally managed with their thyroid, they will not get better. They just will not. And I've seen that a lot in my practice where I've had to tackle their thyroid 2 or 3 months into SIBO treatment because they were just not improving to the extent that they should have. Compliant, motivated patient. They did everything right. Like, okay, we're really going to have to tackle this thyroid. And if you're okay, you know, I'll co-manage with your endocrinologist and we're just really going to get your thyroid optimal. And guess what? Patients get better. So I agree. And I'm glad you brought up the thyroid part, because that is a significant portion. And that's why people need to do the metabolism facet, because if you don't treat, and the goal should be for optimal levels for thyroid, if you don't treat that optimally, and you can talk to that at a lot more length, Guillermo, than I can, but I'm seeing it in my practice every day. If we don't get some of these hormones optimally, if you don't get them out of fight or flight and high cortisol and adrenaline, they're just not going to get better. And it's not just GI imbalances, it's everything, but particularly in GI imbalances. I mean, there's actually a ton of evidence between GI imbalances issue and HPA axis dysfunction, and then also SIBO and thyroid. So the metabolism facet for this was one of the facets while I was researching this that surprised me the most with the amount of evidence that's out there. And it's probably one of the things that I've heard discussed the least in all of this training I've done. And I went to a couple months ago, a day long just GI, advanced GI stuff. And they barely talked about the links with metabolism. Of course, because we all love the advanced testing and all that stuff. So it was really a focus on that. But there was really a big gap with talking about how to optimize a patient's health and not forget these hormones and not forget metabolism. I'm really happy you brought up the thyroid part, because it's so true. It's often, the link is there. It's in the evidence. It's out there. We know this, but it's not managed optimally.
I know that, you know, thing that just popped to my mind, you know, what happens to someone in the middle of Montana that doesn't have access to a functional medicine doctor? And, you know, are you going to allow lay people come in? And what about like health coaches, and how can all of these different populations, how can they benefit from this training?
Yeah, I mean, some of it, if you're not a clinician and you don't order, if you're not ordering labs or testing, I mean, you might be a little bit limited. But we had dietitians, we had mental health people and health coaches beta test our module to make sure that it's also applicable to them. We know it takes a team approach to really get people better. So we want all of this to be applicable. And I collaborate with some amazing dietitians who now are better equipped with understanding the labs that I'm ordering, or some of them are reminding me, Melanie, like, you totally forgot to do a Dutch test on this person. Like, yes, let's look at the HPA axis. It's a collaborative effort. Like, we need help, clinicians. But if the health coach is not aware, like, I collaborate with amazing health coaches locally, and they help me remind me of some of this, and they give me feedback because they're often in touch with these patients more than we are, like sometimes on a daily and weekly basis. And they give me feedback. Listen, I really think there's something going on there. I really think we need to do some more advanced parasite testing. Yeah, actually, I think you're right on. Let's do that. But I've collaborated with people locally who, did the beta testing, but will be doing hopefully the rest of the modules, and be able to help me better help my patient and order the right testing in really a timely fashion. And I collaborated with herbalists, for example, and I've had some feedback from some herbalists who were like, yeah, these modules are going to be applicable, and we're going to be better able to collaborate, because that's what it's about. It's let's get everybody who has strengths in different areas and then collaborate. So people, even if you're not ordering tests or you're not a prescriber, you can still collaborate with the main healthcare provider who's overseeing all of this and make suggestions. And if that main healthcare provider is not open to getting feedback, I think that's a big red flag. I don't know everything. I really rely on the people, like the personal coaches I send my people to, and the dietitians and the health coaches. I need them to support me and to fill me in on what we're doing. There's been things that I collaborate with amazing mental health people in my community. They've given me critical feedback of things that I overlooked or didn't hear properly, but they heard it, they saw it, they like, I really think we need to get next level of testing. I'm really highly suspicious of nutritional deficiencies, and some of them were beta testers. So now they really know the tools that they could potentially have access to through us, through the clinicians. And that's what this is all about. It's about collaborating. We're going to miss stuff. That's just how it is. Hopefully we're not missing the big bad things. We're good at that. But when there's a more subtlety that we're maybe not seeing, not hearing, or there's so much other stuff, that's where collaboration, and that's where this model can really help equip. So this is open to everybody. I'm allowing everybody to have access to these modules. I want people to understand the foundational information. I think it can help anybody regardless of your field. So this is good for anybody, even if you're in the middle of the mountain somewhere and you don't have access to a lot in terms of functional medicine, or a clinician who does integrative functional medicine or a naturopath. But if you know this information, some of the foundational information, then you can be able to advocate better for yourself, which is really important. Like, you empower patients to take charge of their health.
You know, at the core of my education is the ability of the body to heal itself. That's at the core. And I truly believe that we are able to help our patients recover a little bit faster, or a lot faster. We gave the body the correct infrastructure for it to correct itself. You know, like someone with thyroid disease and SIBO, if they moved to a mountain and they ate a perfect diet, and they went to sleep on time, and they had very little stress, all their symptoms will go away eventually. So even if you don't have a practitioner, you can take the steps to identify what is your obstacle to perfect health. And there are some interventions, especially what Rob focuses on. There are some interventions like meditation or yoga, or that are going to help you get better. It might not get you 100% better in 2 weeks, but it will get better eventually. And what we're doing is just expediting that process. Also, by being knowledgeable about your conditions and identifying what's wrong, what's going on in your case, you are going to be more savvy, and you're going to be able to select a practitioner that is going to get you to perfect health faster. Because sometimes as practitioners, I do a lot of endocrinology. So chances are that I'm very biased to testing for hormones, and it's just, I'm just being real. It's just human nature. But if a patient walks in and they say, hey, I've been doing these modules and I think I have a chronic EBV infection, as a practitioner that practices functional medicine, I'm listening now, and I'm going to help you with your hunch, because I don't know you better than you know yourself. So being informed and being able to have a little bit of knowledge about these conditions and identifying these patterns, it's only going to get you healthier faster. So even as a lay person, I think it would be so enlightening to be able to go through this, especially if you've been suffering from a chronic condition that maybe no one believes you have.
I know. Yeah.
Guillermo, do you mind if I interject right here for a point or two on this topic?
I mind, Robert.
So I completely agree. And I think, to be perfectly honest, this, the module is designed as a clinician training program. So, it could be, or it will be a little overwhelming for the lay person. But what's beautiful about it, like you just said, Guillermo, is if you come into it with an open mind and see, well, what should my practitioner be thinking about? What are the types of tests or protocols, treatments I could be expecting? Because, the reality is that, practitioners out there, are ordering lots of tests that potentially they don't need or doing very elaborate protocols. And people will come to you, patients will come to you in a relative state of desperation, depending on how sick they are, and may or may not get taken advantage of financially in this arena. And so I think, I just have to put it out there that by doing this, you can be, like you said, more educated, more informed about what might be reasonable treatments. And then I'll take this even to a second step. I mentioned this in the neuropsych, but the power of belief in your treatment is huge. If the individual believes in the practitioner and believes in the medicine that they're prescribing, the treatment that they're prescribing, then more often than not, whether you want to call it the placebo effect, some other effect, it's going to work. So then why not have some, the modules like PENTAD that's showing people some core treatments that will work. And then say a layperson comes in and listens to it and they believe that this treatment is going to work and they bring it to their clinician. Well, I think we just doubled our likelihood of that, treatment working. They both believe in it and it's a core treatment that probably should work independent of their belief. I want people to see what's out there, what they can do. And like you said, some of the stuff in there, you can do for yourself. The diet and lifestyle core that Melanie mentioned is totally free. So go check it out. And we don't want people to be overwhelmed by the pathophysiology behind the disease. We want it to be practical. So you get the best of both worlds, both from a clinical perspective, what, as a clinician, a practitioner, you can do for your patients. And then, as a evidence base too, with so much research. So you get that sort of practical, but you can also get a, background in science, a background in the pathophysiology. I really think it's the best of both worlds. Given all the training I've done, it really is the best combination, both, as a thorough training and comprehensive, but, it's been ruthlessly designed to be as much as you need and hopefully nothing more.
And having that knowledge about the pathophysiology, I keep going that because that was really cool. Like, for example, going back to thyroid and constipation, let's say you have a patient that suffered from SIBO and they have an autoimmune condition. Now they know to look for constipation. So they don't have to relapse. Now they know that now they understand the connection between sleep and HPA access. And now, because knowledge is power, and being able to give that power to our patients, it's only going to make our healthcare better. Gone are the days where the doctor was it. And truly, in my practice, the patients that I see know more about their disease condition than me. And it's amazing, and I love that about my patients, that they are so educated and they've been at it for so long, and they know what they want and they know how to what to address or how they want their healthcare to be guided. And again, if they know how their healthcare needs to be guided, it's only going to make for a more powerful treatment plan, which is probably going to work better than if they were just being told and dictated what to do.
I agree.
So how many thousands of dollars is this going to cost all of our different practitioners and students, to be able to do this type of training?
Every module is $325 per module, and that includes video, audio, and there's printed handouts that has all the type notes plus some and some screening questionnaires that we've designed. So everything is in one module for $325. We will eventually be offering packages. So if you want to buy three or plus module, there will be some discount prices. But also in light of this podcast, I'm offering a full scholarship, so 100% free for naturopathic students right now. So I want you to reach out to your community and get the word out there, because I studied at Bastyr, and that's really my, the foundation of my philosophy in medicine. And I want to offer a free scholarship to a naturopathic student, and they can reach me at pentadintegrativehealth.com. And just in the contact section. And I'm just asking for just a very basic 300-word essay, a little bit of background information, why integrative functional and naturopathic medicine, and why the GI imbalances module is going to be important to them and how they're going to use it. So outside of paying $325, I'm going to be offering a couple times a year some scholarships. But right now I want to offer the first scholarship to a naturopathic student anywhere at any naturopathic medical school. Get the word out there, go to my website and send me some information. I'll send you a little bit more information if you want some, or you can just send me an essay and just who you are, why you want to use this, and why you love integrative, functional, and naturopathic medicine. May 1st is the deadline. So I will accept submissions through May 1st, but then after that, we're going to give you, Rob and I, all the applicants, and we're going to give one scholarship out, and they're going to get the module for free, and there's probably going to be perks afterwards, so stay tuned. But right now, that's what we're going for.
That makes me so happy, you know, because we're so worried about passing exams, and we're so worried about, you know, milestone tests, and, you know, we want to listen to podcasts, and we want to go to trainings, and we want to, you know, get some of this cool functional testing done. But sometimes it's really hard, you know, and you end up like losing a little bit of time while you're getting your license. So this is amazing, because you can do this at your leisure and seriously finish this course and be able to apply this the next day at clinic.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, so I think we lost an hour because today was daylight savings. Not in Arizona. Arizona gets to have the same time throughout the year, so my circadian rhythm doesn't suffer. But I think Rob is getting cranky, and I think he needs to get his beauty sleep. So,
man, I do need my beauty sleep, Guillermo.
Yeah, well, you got to stay handsome, dude.
I'm pretty.
So before we leave, Rob and Melanie, any parting thoughts? You know, what are your handles? Where can we find you? And, you know, thank you for putting together this program, because it really, really is an amazing tool for practitioners and for students. Yeah,
we're working hard. I'm in the middle of creating our next module, which is going to be the fatigue module, which is a big, big part of what I do and really critical to anyone in integrative and functional and naturopathic medicine. So you can reach Rob and I at Pentad Integrative Health. Pentad stands for 5, so pentadintegrativehealth.com. There's a contact section there, and you can get a hold of me. That's by far the best way to get a hold of me. Check my email every day, multiple times a day. So I'll be looking for the applicants for the scholarship for the GI module. And I also work in primary care in Charlottesville, Virginia. So we have a website at Downtown Family Healthcare, which we're doing great work over there, really addressing all these patients who don't have the means to do and see someone cash pay. So we're seeing amazing amounts of patients there. And I'm there as their functional integrative specialist. That's all I do all day, every day. So I collaborate with all these great minds over there. So that's another way of getting a hold of me. The best way to get a hold of me is my website at pentadintegrativehealth.com.
Rob?
So I am in Front Royal and Winchester, Virginia, sort of the Shenandoah Valley area of Virginia, completing my family medicine residency training. So I'm doing a lot of hospital medicine right now because it's my first year, but I definitely keep myself busy in my free time. I do have a webpage at amedicinalmind.com. I have a podcast there as well. I think the second episode of my podcast series was with Guillermo himself. So you guys, if you haven't listened to that one, go back and listen. It's also with one of our good friends, Allison Crystal. Total plug there. But yeah, I mean, I do blogs and poetry. I kind of, you know, for as much science and as geeked out as I get, I kind of like to live in a little less sciencey world. And so I love the sort of neuropsych, you know, yoga, meditation, writing poetry. So you'll find more stuff there in that realm than medicine. But yeah, if you're a student, medical, naturopathic, resident, you know, what have you, please reach out if you have questions. I'd be more than happy to help you navigate this space. I'm just encouraged every day by the people that reach out and who are so young and so interested. I think we need to push this type of medicine at a younger and younger stage of training, because we can't wait till people are, you know, 50 years old to start practicing this. We don't need 25 years of disillusionment to then see that functional medicine is the right way. So question, you know, if you're at all interested, please reach out and I'll, you know, happily answer questions to help get you started.
Any conferences, any future speaking engagements?
Yeah, I'm actually speaking tomorrow night at the Richmond, Virginia Functional Forum. So I'm going to be speaking there on integrative approaches to weight management. And then I'm speaking in May in Mexico for, it's a functional medicine conference, just FIM. So functional integrative medicine, bioidentical hormone and functional medicine. We're going to be in Guadalajara, Mexico. So I'm going to be talking there in May, and more to come, but I'm organizing a conference on integrative and functional approaches in the context of chronic illness and environmental medicine. So that's going to be in the fall in Virginia. And I think that's it. I have one more speaking engagement that escapes me right now, but that's where I'm going to be in terms of speaking right now.
What about you, Rob?
Yeah. I think you and Guillermo are doing something fun coming up.
Yeah, I sort of dragged Guillermo into something. I think in the beginning of May up in Baltimore, there's the Academic Consortium for Integrative Health, which is really this collaboration between, you know, academic programs trying to further evidence base behind integrative medicine and also core education. I will be there with Guillermo. I really wanted to have a presentation, and we'll have two presentations there, kind of really talking about what I call the informal versus formal integrative health education and what we really need to do right now to help empower this movement. Because to be honest, I went to a major academic institution, but guess what? It didn't have an integrative curriculum. So I had to go seek it myself. So we obviously need to incorporate things like PENTAD and other trainings that are maybe not formalized in the sense that these academic centers believe, but let's present it. Let's throw it out there. So I'm bringing a naturopathic doctor to a predominantly MD conference, and it will be a blast.
It's kind of your blast, man.
So I can't wait for that.
Give us the dates again, Rob.
Yeah, that is May 8th through the 11th. And I think, you know, Guillermo, I think our posters are going to be like the 9th and the 10th. It's in Baltimore, actually.
Oh, in Baltimore. That's right. Yeah. That's right.
Mm-hmm. And then I think, depending on where things go, Guillermo, we're going to be in Montana.
Well, yeah, AHS. So I'm excited about that. And before that, I'll be at PFX, at PaleoFX. And I'm not sure if you guys are going to be able to make it, but maybe next year. It's just such an amazing conference at PaleoFX in Austin. I'm going to drag you to one of these years.
Absolutely. We're going to be so busy.
Yeah. We're going to be traveling all over the place and we'll never be able to practice.
It's going to be so much fun.
Yeah.
No, not the not practicing, but the getting together, hanging out.
Okay, guys. So awesome. You know, thank you for being on the show. I can't wait to get this message out, and good luck. And I can't wait for the next module.
Awesome. Yeah. Thank you so much. Thanks, guys, for listening. This is great. Thank you, Guillermo. You're doing fabulous work.
Yeah. Thanks, Guillermo. This is always a pleasure. Yeah,
see you guys.